And so this mountain and forest hermitages, so people, sometimes they like to go to a mountain retreat, or they say, I'm going to India, I'm going to Nepal to retreat. But actually, that's not always necessary, because it is taught that there are benefits, greater benefits in practicing virtue in a place where the Dharma has not yet spread, as opposed to a place where the Dharma has spread, like in India or Nepal. The Buddha taught in the Samadhi Raja Sutra that if you practice meditation in a place where the Buddha's teachings have spread for 1 year, it is of greater benefit to practice in a place where it has not spread for only 1 week. So that was explained in the section of the benefits of the Dharma practice in terms of the place of practice. And so therefore, it is very beneficial if you practice in your own country, in your own place, your own house. You take a short time to practice, close the door. You have an hour or even just half an hour, or you do a 1 week retreat, do it in your home. And if you have grown used somewhat to practice, then you can practice just a shamatha, calm abiding practice. And here then it says you remain in an ongoing state of non-meditation. And so this ongoing state of non-meditation, so what actually is meditation then? Meditation is this ongoing state of non-meditation, that there is nothing to be done. It means that Mahamudra is to just abide within the natural state of the mind. It is said that it is by knowing the natural state of the mind, there is no other view. And so the nature of the mind is to abide, or Mahamudra, referring to the nature of the mind, means to just abide within this natural state. And so as we abide within this state, we see that thoughts come and go, but these thoughts are impermanent, they're compounds, they're only temporary. The Buddha said, within all beings is the Buddha. Beings are only obscured by temporary stains. And these are the stains of attachment, aversion, ignorance, which always arise, just like the dust particles we can see in a ray of sun, in a sun ray. But they are temporary, they are unstable. And so in this way we can understand the thoughts. The mind itself is like the sky, and the thoughts are like the clouds. And when the thoughts come to an end, when there is a moment of no thought, then there is still the mind, there is still the sky. And that mind, that space, is beyond coming and going, it's always there. In the 37 practices, in the very beginning, it says Chinrezig is the one who had realized that all phenomena neither come nor go. And so actually within that line, the whole meaning is contained. It is actually very helpful to practice those two books together. And when it comes to external meditation, what it refers to is to abide within the natural state of the mind. And that natural state is like a mirror. And abiding within the state means that thoughts arise, but you do not follow these thoughts, and you continue to sustain mental alertness, observing the mind, the natural state. And so in that sense, there is nothing to be meditated upon. And so then non-attainment is attained, Mahamudra is attained. So non-attainment is attained is, you know, when you observe the natural state, then there is nothing, what will be attained, what will be obtained is that which cannot be obtained. In the Heart Sutra, the Buddha said, the bodhisattvas, there's nothing they obtain. Although we do say that the bodhisattvas, they attain these great levels of the past, the bhumis, they attain these high bhumis. So when we hear that, we may wonder, I wonder what they obtain. But then actually, they obtain nothing. And so what's the nothing that they obtain? It's the space-like nature of the mind that they obtain. And by obtaining that, they have obtained the very life force of samsara and nirvana. By attaining non-attainment, the mind becomes very vast, like space. Even on a smaller scale, for example, a person who has cultivated conventional bodhicitta, even if they just think about their own country, for example, if they think, I wish my country to be well, then that person's mind will pervade that whole country. The mind is pervasive like that. And such a person will be fearless, will be courageous, even if he encounters difficulties. Such a person will have love for the country and for the people in the country. And such a person has a vast mind. And so such is the mind of the Buddhas that pervades all sentient beings, because that is where they direct their mind to. In the prayer for excellent conduct, it says that wherever sentient beings pervade, such are the limits, or wherever space pervades, sentient beings pervades, and such are the limits of my aspirations. So wherever there are sentient beings, this is where the Buddha's mind pervades, as this is the Buddha's intention. And so when we meditate in the same way, what we obtain is the mind that becomes vast. And that is something that is a non-attainment. There's nothing to be attained, but the mind becomes vast and all-pervasive. And then it says, the worldly affairs are the useless causes of suffering. Look at the ultimate essential meaning that realizes the futility of deliberate action. And so where has samsara come from? Samsara comes from the grasping, the dualistic grasping to self and others, the belief in their reality, the belief in a concrete reality, and the belief in the existence of our perceptions. And no matter how much we try, if we grasp in such a way, we will never become free. So needless to mention our ordinary mundane activities that we do with a selfish mind, but even if we do Dharma activities with a selfish mind, it will not serve as the cause for attaining enlightenment in the end. Even if it brings us some temporary pleasure, that pleasure itself will turn into a cause of suffering in the end. And we will never be free from samsara. So no matter how much effort we put in to engaging in activities with the body and speech, with a selfish mind, it will only become the cause of suffering. So what are we actually doing? Why are we doing all these things? What's our whole point? Our whole point is to be happy. And so we're trying to be happy, but that way we will never be happy. So although we want to be happy, we are running after suffering. So therefore what we want and what we do is in contradiction. So it says the futility of deliberate action. And so before also, the worldly affairs are the useless causes of suffering. And so we say that our mundane affairs that we consider to be pleasurable are the cause of suffering. And so one may also wonder, like, how does it become suffering? How do, like, all these activities, how do they become the cause of suffering? And there's a way that Lord Chikdun Sumgyon explained it in the Gong Chik, where it is explained quite clearly. And so he said that cause and effect is the reflection of the momentary thought. So the sentient beings in the six realms of samsara have their mind has a single ground. Their mind is the same. And however, although their mind is the same, for example, animals, if you look at animals, their mind is the same, but then there is animals that look very beautiful, and then there's animals who are really scary. And the slightest experience of pleasure or pain that we encounter is the actual reflection of the momentary thought. And this is also how my teacher introduced me, and I found it very beneficial, because in fact I'm a very angry person, so there's nobody more angry. So my teacher said, you're so angry and you won't take it anyway, but now look at a poisonous snake. Do you want to be born like that? And so if you look at a poisonous snake, the poison snake is a reflection of the momentary thought of anger. And it's momentary thought because it arises in just a moment. For example, if you imagine a very pretty girl, and in just one moment, in the next moment she gets angry, then she is not so pretty anymore, and nobody wants to look at her. And so, on the other hand, if you think of a person who maybe is not so pretty, but they have a lot of compassion and love, and then you will always want to look at them. You feel drawn to them. So we can see it's just really a momentary thought. So at the moment anger arises, already it becomes the cause of suffering. So that is what is meant with the momentary thought being reflected. It's just like a seed in the mind. And so the seed for birth in the hell realm, therefore, is anger, hatred. And then the seed for birth as a hungry spirit is stinginess, greed. And then the seed for birth as an animal is ignorance, and so on. The Buddha had introduced us to all those causes. But then those causes all come from a self-grasping mind. And so it means that even if we engage actually in virtuous activity, it becomes somewhat defiled if we do so with a self-grasping mind. And for the most part, it is somewhat mixed. It is partly virtuous and partly non-virtuous. And that also accounts for our mixed experiences of happiness and suffering. And so when you contemplate in this way, I think that all of those activities of body, speech, and mind, all of those worldly activities that I engage in with self-grasping and afflictive emotions have no essence, are useless activities. So if you think in this way, you will see how those useless activities are the cause of suffering and are the seed of the lower realms. So in this way, we can really understand, gain a good understanding how the momentary thought is a reflection, for example, like a poisonous snake. So you don't want to be born as a poisonous snake, and so therefore you should contemplate. So if I do not want to be born as a poisonous snake, then I also do not want to give rise to this momentary thought of hatred or anger. And even if it is a very beautiful bird, like a bird, very beautiful animal, it still comes from ignorance. But then a bird is not horrifying. So we want to be loving to the bird, we want to feed the bird, we want to stroke the bird, or like a cat or a dog. And that's because there is somewhat a partial, a mixture of virtue and non-virtue, so they appear in this more beautiful form. And so everything really arises precisely according to karma. And so this line by Chikten Somgyen, when he said, you know, the cause and effect is the reflection of the momentary thought. So karma is the reflection of the momentary thought. And you should think about this really carefully, because it is really of great benefit. And so to perceive the worldly affairs as the useless causes of suffering, and to realize the futility of deliberate action, is to really ponder and think that all those activities that I engage in with body and speech that come from a place of self-grasping and affliction, these are the activities that are futile or the useless cause of suffering.